Hi everyone. Today I'm here with who might be a familiar face. It's Dianna from Physics Girl.
Hello.
Thanks for being on my channel. We thought that today we'd do a bit of an exam unboxing, which is, you know, a common thing around here, but we're going to look at another very old exam. So we have here the MIT entrance exam from 1876, and we're just going to look at the geometry section of it. Now, Dianna makes for an interesting addition to this video because she actually went to MIT, is an MIT graduate, so it'll be interesting to see if, you know, she can pass the entrance test.
I got in much later than 1876, and in fact, much later than 1976, so I'm sure the requirements have changed. I also love that the exam says arithmetic, algebra, and geometry. Like, math is the only thing you needed to
That's
know.
That's all there is. There's no calculus involved.
No, of course not. There's also no engineering, no physics, no chemistry, no bio knowledge, just math.
Yeah. So I guess an interesting question would be, you know, what did you have to personally do to get into MIT? You know, you probably didn't have to do this.
No, I didn't have to do this. This is so funny. I can't wait until...
We'll show you in a second.
Yeah, I can't wait till you guys see this exam because it's hilarious. So we had the SATs. So you had to take those, which had writing, math, and reading comprehension. And then you also had to take subject tests. So I had to take the physics subject test, which was not easy, and I had to study pretty hard and specifically for, because our physics classes at my tiny private school that I went to high school at only went up to mechanics, didn't go past into any E&M, okay. But there was E&M on this subject test. Yeah. There was nothing calculus-based. so it was just the standardized tests.
All right, so you really had, I guess, had to prove yourself in, you know, physics to actually get it.
I did.
You know, when we show you this exam, in 1876, that was only a few years after MIT came into existence, and I think they just wanted to see that people had a basic education in, in some mathematics, and I think it was more, you know, there were only a few people that could maybe afford to go to MIT or just, you know, had the opportunity to go, so... Probably much less competitive to get in, so maybe the exam reflects that. But there's some interesting vocab we'll show you through, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this honestly, all your comments are making me wonder, like, what it was like at the time. Like, was it really, I assume a lot of people didn't know about MIT in the way that they internationally know about it now, or there just weren't as many people applying. Like, now people apply from all over the country and all over the world, so it's a bit more rigorous.
Yeah. All right, let's have a look.
This is going to be fun.
All right, so this is what the exam looks like. We've got 7 questions on here. This is just geometry. But having a little read through them, some of them it's not even quite clear what they're asking. So I'll read you the first question. So if a straight line drawn parallel to the base of a triangle bisects one of the sides, it bisects the other also. And the portion of it intercepted between the two sides is equal to 1/2 the base.
Yeah, so where's the question?
It's like, okay.
There's not even a question mark or even like a statement of, oh, okay, do this now.
Yeah, so I guess the assumption here is that you have to prove like the latter half of this, but it's interesting that they don't write prove because they do actually in these later questions write prove, like prove the side of the regular inscribed hexagon is equal to the radius of the circle.
Yeah. This one is just, okay, so first of all, it's like they tell you, if this, then that. And then also this happens. And then also this happens. So it feels very much like here's some statements. It really doesn't feel like this is something you should prove, but I can't imagine anything else you would do with it besides prove. I'm surprised at how short this is. Well, I guess, okay, so there's the arithmetic, algebra, and then we're just on geometry. Skip number 6.
So yeah, number 6, it looks like something about a polar triangle, whatever that is, and then see figure on blackboard. So we're missing a bit of information there, but the rest of these, I guess we have enough knowledge to prove them, and it looks like, to me, it seems like it's using school concepts, or at least that I remember doing at school. So having a look at these, like, I don't particularly ever remember doing, you know, questions like this, like defining a frustum, whatever that is. But I do remember, I think, the laws behind some of these geometry questions, and they're really basic things like that angles in a triangle add up to 180, and that you know, angles on a line add up to 180, and that if you have parallel lines and draw a line between them, the corresponding angles you get are equal to each other.
Yeah, I mean, just looking at number two, the diameter perpendicular to a chord. So first of all, you have to know some of these terms. Like, you have to remember what a chord is. And I think I remember that that just means if you have a circle and you have a line going from one part of the circle through the circle to the other part, that's a chord.
Yeah.
Yeah, right?
Yeah, so I think it's tackling vocab here. So we've got chord, we've got bisects. I saw that pop up. Yeah, bisects, so that's splitting a line, I think, equally in half, yeah. I believe. Secant is not actually a word I particularly remember, but I know I've seen before.
Yeah, I did not remember what that was. I thought it was like a mariner term.
But, although considering it's from 1876, I think one thing that is notable is that math doesn't really change that much. So they are still things that seem doable to me, you know, with a modern math education. It's not like fundamentally these concepts are changing. And I think because, you know, the questions are reasonably simple, we still can just figure them out.
That's pretty interesting. I hadn't thought about that, about the fact that this was from 1876. And even still, you know, reading this sentence, I understand basically what they're saying. I don't use the word subtended on a daily basis, but I can get, you know, I can get the point of what they're trying to say. And again, like, they're just stating something here, but it looks like something they want you to prove.
Yeah. So, yeah, if anything, it's surprisingly understandable. I actually think that if we were doing an 1876 English exam, we'd struggle more.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
I think if we were doing a 2019 English exam, I'd struggle more.
Maybe. So let's just solve a couple of the questions to have a look at what the answers basically look like for these things.
Yeah, I'm ready. Let's do it.
Okay, so I'm going to take charge of solving the first problem on here. And I read it out before, but we will draw a little diagram. So we have a triangle. Forgive me for my drawing skills. I'm leaning over the tripod. We have a straight line drawn parallel to the base, and it bisects one of the sides. So, okay, we want to come in halfway between these. Oh, I need a ruler, but that's fine.
Looks good to me.
Bisects the other also, sure. And the portion of it intercepted between the two sides is...
That part was the most confusing to me, so, but they just mean...
I guess they mean this part in the middle, yeah. Intercepted between the two sides is not the phrase I would choose to use, but sure.
The portion between, on the line between the two sides.
Okay, and that's equal to half of this line. So, yeah, let's draw in a few more lines to help us out. So I'm going to draw another parallel line through the tip there, and I guess we can put one there as well. So the cool thing about parallel lines that I remember from school geometry is that if they're parallel and we have a line between them, then... Well, I think it's the alternating angles are the same.
Yeah, yeah. These ones, but then also like these ones.
Yeah, so.
There's got to be a name for those angles.
Let me think about that. So it's this angle here and this angle here, like the interior angles are the same. So those are the same. And then by a similar reasoning, this angle and this angle here will also be the same, like as each other.
Yep.
So we can go from there. Because this line is equal to this line, and also this line is equal to that line, what we're getting at here is we've got some similar triangles going on. In this case, we have, this triangle here would be similar to the larger triangle. So by saying similar, I mean that it's kind of just the same but scaled down a bit. So the ratios between like the sides and the angles should be the same for both those triangles. So that's what I'm going to work with to say that if drawing this line across here has cut this line in half, then because they're similar and they're related by a ratio of 1/2, then I'm going to think that applies to this line on the bottom as well, that because they're similar triangles, these lines would be related by 1/2. So I know I haven't actually written anything down,
But I did look up similar triangles because yeah. I didn't remember what the terms of similar triangle is. But it gives you that the triangles have congruent angles, which means that they have essentially the same angles, which you were talking about how you've got these same angles here and these same angles here. And then this is obviously sharing the angle.
Yeah.
But then that also means that within a similar triangle, you have proportional sides.
Okay, yeah.
Which is useful.
Yeah, so yeah, I think that being able to link them by a factor of a half, I guess that answers the questions. I don't know if my 1876 geometry tutor would be very happy with just my verbal reasoning, but yeah, that's sort of the approach that I would take. So yeah.
Looks good to me. I'd let you in.
Thank you.
So I'm going to take over here for Toby, and I'm going to do number 5, which involves defining the frustum of a pyramid. So I'm going to go ahead and admit that I've already failed this test because I had no idea what a frustum was. I had to look that up. Did you know what a frustum was?
No, I didn't. Okay. So we've had to, you know, look up some things here.
But it turns out a frustum, for all of you who are along with us, maybe some of you knew what it was, but if you have a pyramid and you cut the pyramid partway, then this sort of, that goes all the way down to the bottom. It's this part, like below the cut?
It's the part that's left over after you cut the tip off.
Yeah. Okay, so if we remove the tip, then what you've got left is this kind of, I'm pretty impressed with my drawings. Okay, so what you've got left is like this sort of section of a pyramid, like the lower section. Like you cut off a smaller pyramid and removed it, and then you've got this left. So this is me defining frustum.
You get points for that, it seems, because that's just the first part of the question, like literally define it.
Define a frustum of a regular pyramid. Done. Fist bump myself. And then, or you can fist bump.
Yeah, don't be so lonely.
I'm used to filming YouTube videos by myself. This is amazing. There's somebody else to fist bump me. Okay, and then define lateral area. Also had to look that up, but lateral area is the area of like these sides, the slanted sides. So then there's obviously two more on the other side, but I can't draw this. These two right here and right here. So lateral area. Done. Check. Okay. And then prove, the next part actually tells you to prove. That's very exciting.
How nice of them.
Prove that the lateral area of a frustum of a regular pyramid is equal to half the sum of the perimeters of the upper and lower bases. So this is the upper base perimeter, and then this is the lower base perimeter. Okay, now we're going to prove, multiply by the slant height, and then the slant height is this. This will do H there, slant height. For the sake of hanging out with an Australian, I'm going to call it a trapezoid, but we would call it a trapezoid. So these are all trapezoids on the sides. And to do the area of these, you would, you know, you could imagine that you take this little triangle from this side and move it over to right there. Multiply this height by this base, and you get the area of the trapezoid, which turns out to be this distance here. Turns out to be the average between this distance, this lower part, the lower side of the trapezoid, and the top part. So we're going to call this, I don't know, we'll call this like the base and the top. So to find the average of those, you would do base plus top over 2. And then I want to find the area of this whole thing, and that would be H. So the area of a trapezoid, I mean, the formula for it ends up being the height. Sorry, not this. I meant to refer to this height with my H. Now we're on the right track. This height is H. Now we've got the formula for the area of a trapezoid, which is just the height of the trapezoid times the base length, which is this whole length here, plus the top length over 2. Now, if we sum up all of those, all 4 of them, I'm going to move this over for a second. So we've got all of the top lengths summed and all of the bottom length summed over 2 times h. I'm going to look back at what exactly I was supposed to be proving, which is prove the sum of the perimeters of the upper and lower bases multiplied by the slant height. Half the sum. Cool. Well, I've got my half. Now I've got all of my top sides and all the bases added up. But this right here is the top perimeter. Woohoo! These 4 is the top perimeter. And then these 4 here are the bottom perimeter. So we've got that over 2 times the slant height. And that's what it's supposed to prove, right?
Yeah, I think you've got it. Yeah, that looks pretty good.
There it is. Done. Found it.
You've been admitted to MIT for your second degree.
After having to cheat and look up a frustum.
Yeah. No, I think we got there in the end. So I guess, we've seen what these answers sort of look like. You've seen us sort of struggle with vocab here. But, yeah, I mean, guys, feel free to try some of these questions at home. It's not dangerous. And thanks, Dianna, for joining me in this video.
Thanks for having me. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, so we're going to have a look at another MIT exam over on Dianna's channel, so you guys can go and check out that if you want to.
We're going to look at the first physics class I took, which was called 8012, which is physics for masochists. And this is the final. Oh, very shiny and beautiful and terrifying.
Yeah. All right. Thanks for watching.